Steve, my name is Derek McCullough, and I work in the Research and Development Unit for English Studies, which is just down the corridor here. And we're an English linguistics research group, and for many years we've been, the unit has been. For many years the unit has been developing software to allow the study of language and derive new facts from the language. Probably our most well-known work is WebCol, which allows you just to search for examples of words or phrases in context to extract them from the web. And the latest developments in WebCol have led us to searching and analysing literature, and that has led us to the development of a prototype which I'm going to show you today. So it's called Wiki Without a Name, that's just a working title for me. And it allows users to annotate and discuss the text online. The image on the left is supposed to show the type of traditional handwritten annotations that we're attempting to replicate digitally. And so the wiki is a bespoke system to do this, specifically designed for this task. And although we've called it a wiki, it really only is one in the loosest sense, borrowing ideas from forums or perhaps Twitter-like. So I'm going to show you a simple example. See that various annotations have been made to the text, shown here by the highlighted section. And if we click on one of them, we can see the comment that's been written. This is just labeled clouds and natural image. If we take a look at another one, you can see that there have been follow-up comments, and that various users have started to discuss this point. And they're discussing the personification of the daffodil. And if you want to add a comment, that's very easy. It's added immediately. There's also an automatic update system. So if there are many people working on the text at the same time, like a class of students may do, then it'll be updated on their screens as well. And anything they write will be updated on yours. And so obviously we also need to be able to make the annotations from scratch. So if I highlight a section of the text, I simply enter an annotation here. Could represent all the images of beauty throughout the poem. And submit. And again, it's added immediately. And added immediately to the screen to anyone else who's using it at the same time. So I'll just draw your attention to a couple of other potentially useful features. One is to look up highlighted sections of a text. So if I select the word drop down, I can look it up in that. You see, it means feeling or expressing mirth or cheerfulness. Then what I can do is copy the URL to that page, get back to the wiki, and add a link to it. And I'm going to put that say to definition and submit that. And so any web resource can be linked to any annotation on the wiki in a similar way. So hopefully that's given you an idea of what the wiki is capable of, and now I'm going to pass you over to Derek so we'll talk about how he's made use of the tool.
Thanks, Asi. Thank you. I've been using wikis in the classroom, but not this custom-made one. I've been using PBWiki, and students have been sitting around with laptops and writing comments on texts. But this is slightly different, and it's for a module on Irish writing. I've taught the module for many years, but this is the first time that we're going to use this new tool. Books have evolved for ease of reading, but e-texts, of course, are ideal for searching and annotating. You can erase annotations, you can write further annotations, you never run out of space. What we have here is a contemporary poem by Paul Muldoon called Boon. Describes going up a hillside with a young woman. Boon. And what's the snow that melts the soonest? Mercy was 13, maybe 14. And how would you catch a yellow bin? She was halfway down the mountainside before I realised. I would be right glad if you knew. Next Sunday, her parting shot left me more intent than Lancelot upon the Grail, or whatever it was. Sir Galahad. A yellow bin. I'd consult Will Hunter, who carried a box of matches and had gone by himself to the pictures. He wrinkled his nose. I know green linens you take with just a pinch of salt on their tails. That's according to most people. Yellow bitten. They might be special. And the snow that's first to melt? I'd got that wrong. He was almost certain. The snow that scarcely ever lies falls on a lady's breasts and thighs. That week stretched longer than the creation. We climbed the hills to the highest hill farm, without a word of snow bitten, and viewed the extravagant wilderness of the brawling townlands round the Moy. The cries from the football field grown so dim, we might be listening on the wireless, when I'd all but forgotten that she'd forgotten. Mercy would take me in her arms. So, as is typical with Irish writing, behind this contemporary poem lies a hinterland of material. And you know, my job as tutor is to get students to engage with this. So this one I've annotated, pointing out that boo has a couple of meanings. It's a pun, as a boon is a noun, an advantage, a blessing. It's got an archaic meaning, asking for a request or a gift or a favour. We can also have boon companions, can't we? Intimate companions. So there's a play on words. And you'll see that maybe there's the echo of the boon of a bit as well behind this. So Mercy asks the protagonist a couple of questions. And what's the snow that melts the soonest? This is actually from the oral tradition, a song, common once in England as well as in Ireland. Oh, the snow it melts the soonest when the winds begin to sing, etc. And this is an online source discussion board for oral literature. So, I've used different coloured tags, and you can use these coloured tags as you wish, which is mostly flexible. So for this example, yellow tags I've done for questions of language. Blue tags, as in is in the question about the snow, for rhetoric or poetic structure. An orange tag for nature, these birds that we'll see. And a green tag for Ireland, a bit of fun there. And a pink tag for questions, because there are things in this poem that I don't understand, and maybe someone can tell me, either in the classroom or later on. So Mercy wants to know, how would you catch a yellow bin? Now the answer to that, when we've looked at what lies behind it, is you buy them a drink. But you need to read the other poems to find out why that's the answer. Of course she's called Mercy, because Mercy is a play on words as well, not just a girl's name, but a noun for compassion or forbearance shown to enemies or offenders in one's power from pity. Thanks. In the Irish tradition, deeply embedded as Catholicism is, of course, mercy has a theological definition. And we can look at the Catholic Encyclopedia online and find that mercy, as it is here contemplated, is said to be a virtue influencing one's will to have compassion for, and if possible, to alleviate another's misfortune. So, we've got a couple of... I shall link immediately to the yellow bitten, because I mustn't forget him. Heron-like bird, and you can hear him boo. while he's about to blow, I'll let you into a secret. The Yellow Bittern is a famous poem in Irish by Corhelb Gunn. And Corhelb Gunn was a carter. He'd once trained for priesthood, but he was a drinking man, a big drinking man. And in the poem, he finds a bittern frozen to death on a road by the side of a frozen lake. And he thinks if only that bird could have had a drink, its life would have been saved. So he resolves then and there on the spot never to give up drinking, as the swimming folk want him to, because you know he'll be secure as a drinking man. So if our students aren't familiar with bitterness, they can hear it. Yeah. There we go. Onomatopoeia here in action. Right. I don't know where this comes from. It looks like a quotation, Will Hunters. So you know that's a challenge to you or to the students. There's one stanza of the Irish. This is a translation, very famous translation, by one of the martyrs of the Easter Rising. Took part in the Easter Rising, was executed in 1916 by the British school teacher, nationalist, Irish language enthusiast, Thomas MacDonagh. He translates the Irish, the Yellow Bittern. The Yellow Bittern that never broke out in a drinking bout might well have drunk. His bones are thrown on a naked stone where he lived alone like a hermit. Right. Famous Seamus Heaney has translated this poem, as have a number of other people. Francis Lettwich alludes to MacDonagh in his lament for Thomas MacDonagh. He shall not hear the bittern cry because he was executed, etc. It's a folk song. It's still sung and played in sessions to various tunes in Ireland. Some of those can be heard. And there are various other versions of it as well. So this is evolving. At this stage, it's a demo, if you like, and I would invite students to fill in the blanks. I would also make blank versions with other texts so that they can see how Yeats, for example, reads other people's poems and other people these days respond to Yeats. And the whole thing will evolve, I hope. As a show resource.
Thank you. Thanks very much.